It's the after talk.
After talk.
It is the after
What's
talk.
Up?
I'm meeting after the talk.
Crossroads.
What's up?
After talk.
Crossroads.
It's the after talk, y'all.
Talk.
It's the after talk.
What's up? What's up? What's up? Hello, hello, and how are you doing? Welcome to Upward and Onward Presents, our meeting at the Crossroads Music Series, After Talk. Now, the After Talk is where we actually get a chance to go back a little bit and focus in on some of the interviews that we had earlier in the year with some of the artists. So sit back, relax, snap on a seatbelt, do whatever you got to do, grab some popcorn, because we're about to get nitty gritty and get a little bit around the edges of things, if you know what I mean.
Abigaile Slocum is a New Jersey actress and musician living in New York City. She received a Bachelor of Fine Arts in Musical Theater at Long Island University. Since graduating, she's performed in theaters all around New York and as a solo musician. In addition to theater, she also plays the piano, saxophone, acoustic guitar, ukulele, and mandolin.
Giving you a little proper and country. Howdy, fine people. Hope you all been well. I'm doing as well as one can, considering. No major complaints. Not that anybody would listen anyway.
Hey, man, I listen to you.
Well, thank you, brother from another. Folks, if you're just tuning in, that was my co-host, Bruno Diaz from New Jersey. Forget about it. And I'm your host with the most, Darren Lorenzo from the ATL in Georgia, shout it. We're here once again with some stories of the pandemic, one's journey, their location, and all-around vibe. How's it going? How you feel?
I'm doing good.
Well, I'm happy for you, B. I really am. Okay, moving on. Today we have the beautiful Abigaile Slocum, singer, actress, musician. She's going to invite us into the music field world that she lives in, and I'm going to listen. Well, I hope we all are. Anyway, I know you all are wondering what was my drink of the week. Whiskey again, if you must ask. But rye this time from Tennessee. A Texas-infused pecan with whiskey rye. A Texas in Tennessee? Sounds like trouble. StandardProofWhiskey.com. Actually finished the bottle with Cuzzo J. Willie watching football. Both our teams lost this week. My Falcons. Oh, boy, what the hell, y'all? And Bruno Cuzzo's a Giants fan like you.
Let's go, Giants.
Going strong as hard as we can. 0-2. Just the start of the season, I guess. Won't judge too heavy. But do better, bros. Well, without further ado, let's check in on our Jersey girl, Abigaile, and see how she's doing.
Tears and fears and feeling proud to say I love you right out loud. Dreams and schemes and circus crowds, I've looked at life that way. But now old friends are acting strange. They shake their heads, they say I've changed. Something's lost, but something's gained in living every day.
What's been going on with you?
I'm pretty good, honestly. I escaped the city. I live in New York City, but I'm a bartender in Manhattan. So our bar closed pretty quickly, pretty much right when they said, you know, that's it. Yeah. So I kind of escaped to New Jersey where my parents live.
Okay.
And stayed with them for longer than I anticipated staying with them. But it was nice, you know, like we were in a big house and instead of our tiny apartment, and we all kind of had room and we entertained ourselves. That was good. Just got back to the city a couple weeks ago.
And how has it feel since you've been back?
You know, I think because we got back when things started kind of, you know, opening up a little bit.
Mm-hmm.
It doesn't feel as strange as it did right before we left. It was, you know, nobody was out. Everyone was in a panic and it was very strange. So nobody on the subways or anything like that. Now I think people are kind of easing into it again. So,
yeah.
But it's nice, you know, it's nice to have my own place again. And
I'm sure,
you know, sure.
Trying to share a place with anybody else, but definitely your parents. I'm actually doing that now since the pandemic.
Yeah.
So I know how all that is actually right.
You get home cooked meals though, which is good. So
yeah, so I've gotten that pandemic weight sitting on me a lot heavier than I had before.
Yeah.
It was so funny right before we started the Zoom call. I was just yelling back and forth with my mother because she heard something drop in my room and she's like, hey, everything okay? Like everything's fine, but it's in my room, so don't worry. I just didn't know.
Don't worry about it.
I'm fine.
Yeah.
I'm a grown man.
Excuse me, Mr. Fancy Pants. Want me to get you a popsicle?
Cherry, please.
I ate the cherry. All that's left is green.
You make me want to kill myself.
Just to let the folks know, we were talking a little bit earlier, but your folks live near Asbury Park, which is like Springsteen area. So that's
Springsteen land.
Yeah.
And you know what? Everyone worships Springsteen, and he's like,
of course, he's a god. Yeah.
A legend. Yeah, he's a god.
When did you get into the industry? When did you start singing and performing?
My parents put me in piano lessons when I was, I think, 4 years old.
Okay.
It was just like an after-school activity. Like, I think it was part of the curriculum or something. So then when that year ended, all my other friends were like, we are not taking piano anymore. Like, they hated it. But I was obsessed with it. It was one of those things where, like, my parents never had to force me to practice like my friends.
Okay.
I just loved it so much. I loved music. I loved playing music. It was sort of like the thing I did to relax and like unwind. So then I played piano for years and years. I picked up the saxophone too when I was 9 or 10. And actually, I picked the sax because of Clarence Clemons from Springsteen.
Okay.
Yeah, I love Clarence Clemons.
Full circle there.
So I played the sax. And then I'm not sure when I started singing. I think it must have been around the same time. It was probably just like a natural thing to do while I played music.
Uh-huh.
But I started doing theater when I was 9.
9, okay.
I was just in like a school musical.
Yeah.
And then I became hooked on that.
Yeah.
And just continued doing theater all through school. I like started doing summer theater, like kids summer theater. And then that moved to like community theater.
Mm-hmm.
And then that moved to small regional productions when I was a little bit older.
Okay.
And then I went to college for musical theater. And here I am.
Look at you. Here you are. So you're very musical. I mean, did you continue with those instruments, the saxophone and the piano?
Yeah, I've been playing the sax and the piano. I picked up about 6 months ago, I picked up the guitar, the acoustic guitar as well.
Look at you. All right.
Yeah, which I had always wanted to learn, but I just never really had the time.
Uh-huh.
And I just decided a couple months ago, I was like, you know what? This guitar has been sitting in my apartment for so long. It's time to use it.
Yeah, there we go.
So I've been really, really enjoying that.
Well, that's great. I mean, you need to start your own band at this point.
Yeah.
Me and Bruce Springsteen can come see you.
Oh, man. The dream.
What is something that you've learned about yourself during this pandemic, good or bad?
My first first instinct would be to say I've learned a lot about kind of prioritizing my career and my passion over my survival job, because before this, I was really letting my job kind of drain me, and I was making up excuses to not work on my career.
Yeah.
Mother cannot guide you. Now you're on your own. Only me beside you. Still you're not alone. No one is alone. No one is alone. Sometimes people leave you halfway through the wood. Others may deceive you. You decide what's good. You decide alone.
But I really think that the most important thing that I learned was regarding the Black Lives Matter movement. I was kind of always someone that never really thought that my voice mattered very much, and my little voice wouldn't affect anything. It wouldn't make a difference, you know, what I spoke up about. But that's just not true. And I think that's the most valuable thing I've learned, is all of our like small voices are a chip in a bigger crack. And if I don't speak up, that's a problem.
Yeah.
You know, like that's really, not only is it not helping, it's making the problem worse.
Yeah.
So I'd say that's the most important thing I've learned, is to just kind of, I've had so many like privileges in my life, and it's past time for me to kind of stop thinking about myself and lift other people up, and, you know, just step out of the light and let other people have their time, because.
Well, it's definitely appreciated. And I wish more people thought like you. And that's just definitely the way to go. And I know I've been approached by a lot of my friends that say, you know, what can I do? What can I say? I say what you can. I say, do what you can. Everybody's going to take it differently. Everybody's going to need something else. I say, me just knowing that you're there is good.
Yeah.
Most might need a conversation, or maybe they just need you to listen to them. Mm-hmm. So whatever it is that you have to offer of anything positive and good, I think, it's, you know, it's very, very welcome. So I just want to say that.
Of course, yeah.
My love took it down. Climbed a mountain and I turned around. And I saw my reflection, snow-covered hill. But the landslide brought me down. Oh, mirror in the sky, what is love? Can the child within my heart rise above? Can I sail through the changing ocean tides? Can I handle the seasons of my life?
I'm not going to keep you too much longer, but I did want to, you know a couple other things. Who are some of your influences as far as music?
Oh, man. I'd say my number one, like, influence my entire life is Judy Garland.
Oh, wow. Okay.
Yeah, I love Judy Garland. Her record is right there.
Okay.
It's all over my apartment. She's definitely, like, my number one favorite artist ever. Then I would say probably Billie Holiday.
Oh, nice.
Yeah, I love Billie Holiday.
In all the old familiar places.
It would be a tie between Joni Mitchell and Carole King, for sure.
That's a good tie. That's a good tie.
Yeah.
Now, do you sing music from each one of these artists that you name?
I do, yeah. Okay. Since I've been focusing a lot on, like, my guitar lately, I've been sticking to, like, 60s, 70s, like, Carole King, Joni Mitchell.
That's a good era. That's a good era, though.
Led Zeppelin, yeah, all that great, like, Bob Dylan, all that folk rock.
Yeah.
But then as far as, like, if I'm performing in, like, a piano bar, I usually head towards Judy or Billy or those old 30s, 40s jazz things, all that good stuff.
It's a wide range, and I think, yeah, that's definitely going to be beneficial in your career, as well as that's very welcomed in a lot of things that we do, even with theater-related stuff, is just to make sure that we have a wide array of things that we listen to.
Yeah.
Talent, her voice, and musicianship is worthy of applause, most definitely. Such a sweet spirit she has. You don't have a lot of people concerned about everyone's well-being, and it seems she's so sincere in her approach, thoughts, actions, and passion. It's so much appreciated and highly favored, Abigail. United we stand, divided we fall. As Bob Marley sang, one love, one heart. Let's get together and feel all right. Give thanks and praise to the Lord, and we will feel all right. I'm Darren Lorenzo, and this has been After Talk. We out. On behalf of Up With It Onward Productions, we'd like to thank you for hanging out for our meeting at the Crossroads, After Talk. Now, your attention and time is much appreciated, and we look forward to having you checking in for more later on. Remember, success is only an arm's length away. Stay safe, stay home if you can, and if not, keep practicing social distance with a healthy and cautious way of life. Up With It Onward, folks.
After Talk, what's the haps? What's the scoop? What's going on? After Talk.
It's the After Talk.